The Segal Pickproof is the most incredible pin tumbler lock that you have likely never heard of, with an equally fascinating history. It was initially patented in 1937 by Samuel Segal, a retired police officer who was best known for the Segal Jimmy Proof deadbolt. Mr. Segal was so confident that his lock was impossible to pick that he inscribed the words Pickproof on the face of the lock and widely advertised that his lock was indeed pick-proof. A complaint was issued to the Federal Trade Commission in 1939, and Samuel Segal was taken to court. The court took the definition of pick-proof as being any non-destructive form of opening the lock, and three locksmiths had testified that they had previously picked this lock. To prove that the lock was not pick-proof, the Segal Pickproof lock was installed on the door of the hearing room. Only the examiner and the locksmiths were inside the room as to protect their trade secrets. After 30 minutes, the door was picked and unlocked. Samuel Segal lost the case and stopped manufacturing one of the most pick-resistant locks ever produced. Today, after 80 years, we'll see what it takes to pick open that Segal Pickproof. Let's take a closer look at this lock. The Segal Pickproof is a 5-pin tumbler lock with gin security drivers. Locks with gin drivers typically have countermilling in the plug of the lock. Countermilling is the widening of the pin chamber below the shear line so that it matches the shape of the driver pin. This is what gives the gin spool driver its unique picking characteristics, as it will directly interact with and get locked into the plug. Some locks, like the Ruco 500, use a stationary sleeve around the plug of the lock, which acts as countermilling. This is accomplished by milling off the top of the plug above the pin chambers and then encasing the plug with a sleeve. This gives the lock similar functionality to direct countermilling. The Segal Pickproof takes the sleeve concept one step further. The Pickproof takes the sleeve and cuts it in half. The bottom half of the sleeve is fixed to the plug. The top half sits on top of the plug and is mobile. It can move side to side. The space between the plug and the mobile sleeve acts like countermilling, and for simplicity will be referred to as pseudo-countermilling. This is the plug of the Segal Pickproof with its fixed lower sleeve, and this is the mobile sleeve, which, when placed atop the plug, move side to side. Now that we have the basic anatomy down, let's see what it takes to pick this lock. In order to understand how the mobile sleeve functions, we should first review how standard gin locks are picked. The first step in picking gin spools is to get all the gin drivers into the countermilling. This allows the lock to enter a deep false set. Next, each gin head in turn is picked above the shear line by a process known as float picking. Float picking is using fine control over manual counter rotation to unlock the head of the gin from the countermilling and lifting it above the shear line. Between each pin, you can re-enter a false set, and in some locks, a deeper false set will favor dropping less pins. If you attempt to pick the Segal Pickproof in this manner, it will not work. Let's take a look at what happens. The gin driver is initially picked into the pseudo-countermilling, and a deep falset is entered when the plug is maximally rotated in the counterclockwise direction. This action causes the sleeve to be maximally rotated to the right, as you can see at this point here, in which it abuts the lower stationary sleeve. In order to unlock the gin heads from the pseudo-countermilling, you must then rotate the plug in the clockwise direction. The initial rotation will cause the plug to move without the sleeve. At this point, the gin head is still fully locked into the pseudo-countermilling. The problem now is that the sleeve has the ability to move in this direction, so that any attempt to lift the gin driver past the sleeve will cause it to move to the right and drop any of the set pins. So how do you pick the pickproof? Let's take a look at this in more detail. By minimizing the rotation into the false set, you can effectively immobilize the sleeve. How does this work? Using very controlled tension in the counterclockwise direction, the gin is lifted so that it just rests above the plug and the shallowest of false sets is obtained. Now the sleeve is maximally rotated and abutting this point as before. With minimal clockwise rotation and upward pressure on the pin may be set above the shear line without disturbing the relative position of the sleeve. The sleeve is always maximally rotated and in essence immobilized. This greatly reduces the dropping of set pins, but in no way eliminates it. The drawback of this method is that the feedback of a set pin and an unset pin is very difficult to differentiate. The best way that I have found to reliably set the gin is to feel how high they are set in the counter milling, and then, by experience, know how high they must be set so that they clear the shear line. Once you are convinced that all the driver pins are resting above the shear line, you can attempt to open the lock. The problem is that if you are incorrect and rotate the plug with even one pin that is not above the shear line, the gin gets locked into the mobile sleeve and you have to reset the whole lock and start from the beginning. Now, if that wasn't enough, there's one last anti-pick feature that Segal put into this lock, which requires a close look at the key pins. When we take a look at a set of the Pickproof key pins, there is one feature which stands out. There are two key pin diameters, small and large. The smaller diameter key pins are more challenging to pick as they slide off of the pick tip. These small diameter key pins were also likely used to thwart pick gun and bumping attacks. There are typically one or two small diameter key pins placed in each lock. All right, let's get to picking. Okay, I'm super excited to show you the first time this lock has ever been publicly picked for over 80 years of its existence. The method I'm going to be using is not how the locksmiths involved in the Segal court case opened this lock. We're going to be talking about that later when I gut the lock. I'm using two tension wrenches up top for fine control of the plug. The lock will be tensioned in the counterclockwise direction, and manual counter rotation will be in the clockwise direction. I'm going to be using a Sparrows steep hook in 20,000ths for lifting all the pins to the counter milling, as well as setting pins 3, 4, and 5 above shear. Pins 1 and 2 will be set to shear using a Peterson hook, number 5 in 18,000ths. One thing to note is how shallow of a fall set I maintain throughout the pick. As discussed in the introduction, this is necessary to keep the sleeve stationary and to avoid locking in the gin heads into the sleeve irreversibly. This is the Sparrow steep hook in 20,000ths. Click at a 5, click at a 4, going to the front. That's a click at a 1, click at a 2. Finally, a click at a 3. And I'm just going over all of them one more time to double check that they're into the counter milling. And I will check that by entering a very small falset. That was it. And now I'm going up front with a Peterson hook number 5. So I'm on number 1. And that's a tiny little click. Going to number 2. Little tiny click. I'm going to go back to 1. That's a click. And now back to 2 again. And that's a nice click. We're going to switch up the hooks. We're going to go to the back. 5 heel set. Little click out of 4. 3. Back to 5. Nice little click. The clicks that you hear in this part of the pick is the gin heads being nudged past the edge of the mobile sleeve across the shear line. Some of them may be the pick slipping off the key pin and striking the plug. Really nice click out of 5, nice click out of 4, click out of 3. And what's really common with this lock is as you set one pin, another one drops. Number 1, number 2, number 1. And what you basically have to do is just recheck everything over and over and over again, because if you turn that core and you're wrong, everything gets locked up. Click on 5 again, another click on 5, that's 4, 3, 5, another click out of 4, click out of 3. Just keep on going through them, rechecking over and over again. Going back to the front. That's a click out of one. Two feels set. Gonna go back to the back of the lock. Five feels set. Pick slipped off. Four. Click out of three. Five, pick keeps slipping off. Four, set, three, click. Going back to the front. And I think everything is set at this point, but let's recheck. This is number one. That's feeling set. Number two. That feels nice and set. So it feels good. Back to one. That feels good. Let's go to the back of the lock. Five feels good. Four feels good. Three feels great. I think we're there. Okay, so at this point, I think everything is set. Moment of truth. Nice. So if the courts ruled that the Segal had to be picked in the traditional manner, then this is how it would have had to be done. However, the court's definition of picking was any non-destructive form of opening this lock. So then how was it done during trial? Well, I know a locksmith whose mutual associates were actually the locksmiths involved in this trial. Apparently, there were two methods implemented. The first was a tool that somehow was able to immobilize a sleeve as the pins were picked. The second was using a thick substance like petroleum jelly to immobilize the sleeve while picking. However, the best method would really be a decoding attack. If you pick all the key pins into the pseudo counter milling and then measure this height, add a factor to account for the sleeve height, you can easily cut a key for this lock. I've also been told that impressioning would likely be very effective against this lock. However, I will not attempt this as this is a very rare lock. This is the housing of the lock. There's nothing really special about it. Here's the plug with the stationary sleeve on the bottom, the keyway up front. Let's take a nice look at that mobile sleeve. Here it is and how it interacts with the rest of the plug. Finally, the pins. The key pins are on the bottom. Key pin number 2 and 5 are the thin ones. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is the Segal Pickproof. I cannot begin to explain to you how excited I am to have shared this lock and pick with you. I've been working on this video for several months, and I really hope that you enjoyed this presentation. If you did, please let me know. Like, comment, and subscribe, and I'll see you at the next one.